Okay, this is now Chapter 7 material. So you're welcome to, of course, watch it ahead of time, but really, we should be done with our exam number 2, and then this would be moving on after exam number 2. And I still haven't worked out the details of exam number 2 yet as I record this video. When I send out this link, I will send out a link to a video I made a couple years ago, teaching at another school. It's again very crude. It's different from these videos because I'm actually teaching at the board, but I'm holding my phone in my hand as the camera, and it's very poor quality, but it conveys some basic introductory topics about algebra. It's how I kick off my beginning algebra classes, and I made that video to send it actually to the folks at CLC when I was looking for them to hire me there. It's just kind of a, here's my style kind of thing. So, and they hired me anyway, can you believe it? Anyway, we're going to dive into Chapter 7, okay? Chapter 7 in our book, Linear Equations and Inequalities. Okay, we're going to start solving equations in this section. Alright, so if we look at page 316, the first thing we need to kind of get accustomed to is something called variable notation. Okay? Up until now, we haven't really had any letters of the alphabet involved too much in our problems. We did a little bit, but not too much. Okay? And now we're going to kind of formally look at those equations. You know, when we did the percent problems, what is 12% of 87? We translated that actually into an equation. We said, what, that's my unknown, I call it x, is equals, remember these problems, of means times, and this was an equation that we had to solve, and we kind of had three different ways to tackle a problem like that. That's algebra. It was so much easier, I thought, to do it that way as opposed to that whole PBR little formula business with the pie charts and things that the book had. But it required a little bit of algebra to get it done, okay? So now we're going to really formally tackle, that algebra. Alright, so this whole thing about variable notation, that's the XYZs, okay? They represent numbers, okay, but at present time we don't know what the number is, so we just give it a name, like the name X, the name Y, the name Z, ABC. You know, we can pick whatever letter we want, really, if there's no guidelines. Alright, so example 1 on page 7.1 is diving into the world of equations, okay? There's two things, and I mentioned it in that other video that I made. There's expressions. You know, if I just say x plus 3, that's an expression, okay? X is holding the place of some number. I don't know what the number is right now, so I call it x, but it's an expression. And we call these parts of the expression terms, okay? There's a variable term, and there's a constant term. Okay? And I discussed in that other video that variable terms always have two parts, a number out front, which I didn't show here. Let me stick a number in here. A number out front that we call the coefficient. And then the letter itself is called the variable. Okay? Together, they make up the variable term. Alright, but sometimes you don't have that letter, that number out front, that coefficient. Like if I just wrote x plus 3, we have to understand that there's really a 1 there. It's just not shown. Okay, and it's a relationship of multiplication. That's 1 times x. And 1 times something is always the same something, right? When you multiply by 1, it doesn't change anything. So we just don't write it, but it's there. Those two things are identical. Okay, these are all what we call expressions. Okay, equations are two expressions set equal to one another . Okay, two expressions set equal to one another. So, we'll get to this point now where we have x plus 3 equals, 5x minus 4. We'll get to that. Okay, it's not as challenging as it may seem right there. Okay, but prior to that, Example 1 wants us to just verify whether or not certain equations are true, and they really don't look like equations, but what makes an equation is the equal sign. Okay, it's right in the name. Equation has an equal sign. Okay, expressions do not have equal signs. Equations do. All right, so example 1, though, it doesn't even look like an equation because there's no variables, but we're asked, is this an equation? Is it a true statement or not? An equation must be a true statement, because what does equal mean? It means it's the same. So if there's something that violates that equality, then it's not an equation. Okay, so this example 1 is just asking us to verify, is this a legit equation or not? So are these two things really equal like the equal sign says they are? So we have to do a little homework here to verify, and we say, yeah, that one looks good. That's a legitimate equation. Okay, part B says 12 minus 3 equals 2 plus 7. Okay, it's an equation. There's an equal sign there, but we need to make sure it's really correct. 12 minus 3 is a 9, and 7 plus 2 is also a 9, so yeah, also a good legitimate equation. Okay? How about this one? Is 12 minus... Oh, no, that's it. Okay, sorry. Okay? So, yes, we verified that those two equations are legit. All right. Now we're going to introduce variables. Okay, again, X and Y are kind of the most common, but you'll see the book is going to use all kinds of letters. The letter N, A, B, C, whatever. A letter, a placeholder, a name to call something because we don't know what it is. Okay, it's just a name. Well, in these first little equations now, in example 2, we're actually going to solve the equations, but you'll see they're pretty easy to solve. We don't have to do a whole lot of work to solve them. Example 2 on page 317, X equals 3 plus 8. The goal of equation solving is to find X. Okay? Tell me what X is. X is the unknown here. X equals some number. Tell me what the number is. So we have to perform various maneuvers to get to the point of X equals some number. And you can see there's only one maneuver to perform here. I have to put the 3 and the 8 together to say X equals 11. Okay? Part B of example 2. 18 divided by 3, now we're switching to the letter N, equals N. It doesn't matter if the N is on the left or if the N is on the right. If I wrote it like this, or if the book had given it to us like this, it's the exact same thing. Okay? One side equals another side. Doesn't matter which side it's on. Our job is to simplify now and find out what this value of n really is. It's some number. What's the number? Well, all I have to do to find it here is perform that division, and I'm going to get n equals 6. Okay, part C. Y equals 3 times 4 minus 5. Okay, now we got to remember our order of operations rules, which is always going to be the case as we keep getting more and more complicated with things. We can't remember, we can't forget the basics. Order of operations, how do I knock this down? Well, first I must multiply and get the 12. And then I'm going to subtract the 5, and I'm going to say Y equals 7. Okay? So there's properties of symmetry and equality involved with an equation, an equal sign. You know, if I tell you some A equals B, that's the same thing as B equals A, right? We've always known that. We just maybe never thought about it that way. Okay, if one thing equals another thing, I could turn it around and read it backwards and they're still equal. Okay? So, terms, this concept of terms at the bottom of 317. To identify terms, let me read the little green box here. Yeah, let me put it under the thing. Separate an expression into terms by identifying additions or subtraction signs that are not within a grouping. So terms, are, I say in that other video, are just a bunch of stuff added together, right? The sign of each term is the sign that precedes the term. So a bunch of stuff added together. Or subtract, it would be terms. So, you know, this first example here, 3a plus b, well, there's two terms here. This term plus that term. two things added together, two terms. The second one is really only one term, because I only have, you know, we have a number next to a parenthesis, there's a multiplication there, right? So I really only have one thing times another thing, so it's only one term. Here, like, I have one thing times another thing here, and it's a single term. Same thing there, except that's just a little more complex. Now, if we applied what's called the distributive property to this, where we take the 3 and we multiply it across and we'll do stuff like this, we could turn that into 3a plus 3b. Well, now it's going to have two terms if we do that. Okay? The final example there has got a big old fraction. It's got a negative sign in front of it even, but it's just one entity, one fraction. There's no addition or subtraction of this term to something else. It's a single term. It's just got a little complication to it. So one term. Okay. So example 3 wants us to identify the terms of certain things. Just kind of what we just did there. 3x plus 5. Identify the terms. How many are there? Well, there's a term and there is a term. There's two of them. Okay. We got it. Part B, 2ab plus 4a minus b, oh baby, look at this one, plus 2 parentheses a plus b. Okay? Ask yourself, how many things are added and subtracted together? Okay? Here's an entity plus, there's an entity plus, or minus in that case, there's an entity plus, there's an entity, okay? Look at the additions and subtractions that separate the pieces, and those are the terms. Yes, that last one's a more complicated looking term, and the first one's a little more complicated too, but we're looking for the separation of addition and subtraction to separate those terms, okay? So I would have four terms in that case. Okay, part C is a big old fraction like that one we just had. Again, there's no addition or subtraction separating this piece from another one. So it's just one big old piece there. So it's a single term. And then finally, I've got 2a over 3. Ah, plus sign, plus 1. So I have an entity here and I have one here with a plus sign in between. So there's two terms there. Okay? I mentioned in that other video that the kind of the variety of terms, the possibility of terms, we could have what's called a constant term if it's just a good old number. A 1 is a 1 is always a 1, right? It doesn't change. But when I have this letter in here, it's called a variable term. That letter A, who knows what's going to happen with that letter A? Its value may vary, so we call it a variable term. Okay? So far, so good. The numbers in front of terms. Let me switch to a new page here. As I mentioned again in that other video, and also I'll do it right now, this number in front is called the coefficient. Okay? Coefficients can be positive, or I could sneak a little negative in there, and they could be negative. Okay? If I just have, again, remember I said there's always a coefficient in front of those variables, but sometimes I might write something like that where there is no coefficient showing. Well, there's a 1 there. I'm just not showing it. And if I stuck a negative sign in front of it, then there's really a negative 1 sitting there. That's really negative 1x plus 3. Okay, not a negative. I didn't distribute. Okay, not this. Not that. That's not what I did, because we'll talk more about this, and we have already. When you distribute a negative 1, now it turns everything into negatives. Okay, I could write it like that, or I could write it like that. Same thing. I prefer that one in the middle. It's a little simplified. Okay, but that's not what I did here. Here I just put a negative in front of the x, which means negative 1 times x. Okay? All right. If we look at page 319, write variable interpretations of symbolic statements. Oh, baby, look at that. We're going to do some translating in this class, okay? Right now, they're just asking us to take an equation and kind of go backwards. Turn it into words, okay? Let me pull the book up for this one. If you look at example 5. State the equation in words. Well, I've got x minus 7 equals 4 there, right? So what am I going to do? I'm going to subtract 7 from x, and I'm going to get the result of 4. Okay, so I could say x subtracted from a number gives 4, or yields 4, or is 4. X subtracted from a 7, pardon me, 7 subtracted from a number. When we see that word, those words, a number, that's just some mystery number. We don't know what it is, so we call it x or y or z. Okay, part B, a number, that's my mystery x, divided by 5 is 3. A number divided by 5 is 3. Another way to say that would be to say the quotient of a number and 5 is 3, or gives 3, or yields 3. Okay, part C. 15 is the result when 3 is added to 2 times a number. Okay, well, we could say twice a number plus 3 is 15. We could say the sum of 2 times a number and 3 is 15. The sum of twice a number and 3, sum means we're adding. Okay, twice a number increased by 3 is 15. There's lots of different ways to write this in words. Okay, part D. If the sum of a number and 3 is doubled, the result is 14. Take the sum of a number and 3. Sum means I'm going to add a number and 3 together and double the whole thing. So I got to have that parentheses. That is 14. Okay, that's a pretty good way to say that. Okay, we got to be careful. If I were to say twice a number and 3 is 14, well, let me write that down. Twice a number and 3. Am I saying this? Twice a number and 3 is 14. Am I saying that? Or am I saying twice a number and 3 is 14? You see, there's a big difference between those two. So the wording sometimes can get a little confusing, too. We got to watch out. And I don't go crazy beating you up with complicated wording to trick you, okay? I'm going to stick with the basics here. Okay? So, the bottom of 319, now we're going to go the other way. We're going to read the written word, and we're going to write down the mathematical expression or equation in this case, okay? If you look at example 6, in fact, let me bring the book back. The sum of 12, 23, and a third number is 52, okay? The sum of, means I'm adding. I'm adding a 12, I'm adding a 23, and I'm adding some mystery third number. I don't know what it is. I'll call it X. Is means equals. Remember that from before? Is means equals 52. There we go. 12 plus 23 plus X equals 52. Example 6, page 320, part B. When a number is subtracted from 45, the result is 17. Always watch out for those words, subtracted from. When I'm subtracting from something, that means that something's got to come first. So I'm taking a number, mystery number, don't know what it is, and subtracting it from 45. So the 45 comes first. I'm going to subtract away some mystery number, and I'm told when I do that, the result is 17, so equals 17. Okay? Let's look at these keywords here. Addition, okay, sum, we hopefully know that one by now. Certainly we know plus, increased by, let me try to zoom in here. Oh, look at that. No, I'm not going to get used to this crazy teaching remotely stuff, but I'm doing the best I can. Zoom in there, buddy, focus, there we go. The sum of, okay, and let me back up so we know what we're talking about. All right, these are all addition. The sum of, okay, plus we know is addition, increased by, okay, kind of common. If I'm increasing by something, I'm adding it. More than, added to, exceeds, longer, all these buzzwords mean I'm going to add. The total of a bunch of things totaled together. If something's heavier, older, wider, taller, all these words we know, greater than, more than, all these words mean I'm going to add things together. Subtract, less than, decreased by. Okay, subtracted from. Some of these subtractions we have to write backwards. We got to watch out for them. The difference between two things. Right? Remember we had a question on the last test that what's the difference between, you know, 5 3/8 and 2 1/4 or whatever. And we had to subtract those two things to get there. Multiplication. Let me do a little bit more. Reduced by, diminished, minus, less, shrinks. We know all these words to mean something smaller. We just maybe haven't seen them in a form of a math problem before. Multiplication means times, multiply, of. Remember I said the word of means time. What is 12% of 87? I said of means times. The product of. Product means times. Division, we know divide, divided by, divided into. How big is each part? Yeah, that means I'm going to subdivide it into parts. The word quotient is mysteriously missing here. That should be in there. That's the biggest one for division. Quotient. Okay. Translate the statement into symbols. How many shelves that are 3 feet long can be made from a board that is 12 feet long? Okay. I'm dividing that 12-foot board into a bunch of smaller pieces. How am I doing that? Well, I'm going to have a bunch of little three-piece pieces, and I'm going to see how many I can get to make that 12. Okay? So ultimately, what I'm going to be doing is taking 12 divided by 3. And I know the answer is 4, but if I want to set it up as an equation, say I'm going to have a bunch of boards, 3 feet long each, but I don't know how many. So times X number of boards, but all together they're going to equal 12. Okay, and we'll talk about how to solve that equation. We're going to ultimately divide by 3 to solve that equation. Okay, we'll get to that. Okay, example 8. Then I'm going to stop the video here. Explain the difference between these two statements. 4 times the difference between a number and 8 is 24. So let me write that down. 4 times something. So I'm going to open a parenthesis because there's something in there. What's in there? It's a difference. That means I'm going to subtract between a number, which I'll call x, and 8. So 4 times that difference is 24. Okay? One way to, that's how I would write that one. The second statement, the difference between 4 times a number and 8 is 24. So the difference between something, the difference between what? 4 times a number and 8 is 24. Okay? Big difference. In one case, I've got the 4 outside the parentheses, which means I would ultimately distribute it across to both of those, right? But on the other case, it's only 4 times x. It's not 4 times 8. So there's going to be a big difference between these two. So you got to read very carefully and translate very carefully on these problems. Okay, we'll wrap that up for here. We'll start on page 321 in a moment.